I'll begin this afternoon's session with a brief introduction. Welcome to the Canadian Institute of Forestry's National Electronic Lecture Program. My name is Sharon Yang, and I will be hosting today's session. Today is Thursday, December 5th, 2024, and this is the last session in the e-lecture series entitled Inspiring Community Action, Connection and Stewardship. How can civic involvement support Canadian urban forests? This series is brought to you by Tree Canada. The CIF-IFC is very pleased to collaborate with Dr. Audrina Bardakchian and the team at Tree Canada to host these webinars. Today's webinar is titled Key Lessons to Improve Cross-Sectoral Collaboration for Urban Nature-Based Solutions. A special reminder that the ISA certified arborists are eligible to receive one continuing education unit for this webinar. Please email electures@cififc.org with your full name and ISA certified ID in order to obtain the ISA continuing education unit. Once we verify your attendance, we will send your information to ISA for them to process. Today, we have Kaylee Hutt-Taylor, Coordinator of Research and Engagement from Tree Canada, to introduce today's e-lecture speaker. With that, I will now pass it over to Kaylee.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much again for taking the time to join us today for our final e-lecture session. On behalf of Tree Canada, we're so pleased to be bringing together forestry and allied professionals to learn on this important topic of community stewardship and action. Thank you again, Sharon, for all your coordination and to the Canadian Institute of Forestry for partnering with us for this e-lecture series. I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker today, Dr. Carly Ziter. Carly is an associate professor of biology and the university research chair in urban ecology and sustainability at Concordia University in Montreal. She and her students combine fieldwork, data synthesis, and participatory approaches to better understand how nature-based solutions contribute to biodiversity conservation and human well-being in and around urban areas. Carly is truly a gifted communicator and passionate knowledge mobilizer. I'm looking forward to learning alongside everyone this afternoon during her talk. Please take it away, Carly.
Okay, thank you, Kaylee, for that lovely introduction and to Sharon and Audrina and the entire kind of Tree Canada team for inviting me here to just share some of our work today. It's great to see so many people in the virtual audience out there on Zoom. Everyone can hear me okay? You can see the slides that you're supposed to be seeing. We're all good to keep going?
Yep.
Perfect. Thank you. Okay. So I am joining you today from my office at Loyola University or Concordia University at our Loyola campus, which is in Montreal or Jojoke, located on unceded Indigenous land. And the Kanyaganhaga Nation is recognized as the custodians of the land where I conduct much of my work. Today, I am talking to you about something that is a little different than what I usually do, a little new, which makes it exciting. And so most of my time as a professor and teacher and communicator here at Concordia University, I am like a boots on the ground field ecologist, or at least my students are. Now, mostly I do the paperwork for them to be boots on the ground field ecologists. But as a lab, what we try and do is actually go out and like measure and map and understand the ecology of our cities and how that contributes to nature-based solutions. And so we're out there like measuring trees and adding temperature and noise sensors to the environment to understand what's happening in these systems. We're identifying plants. We're really doing the things that field ecologists do. And I love to talk about these things. And so I'm happy to chat about any of these other projects, you know, if we have time today, but I'm easy to find in the future. But what I was invited here to talk about today was actually a participatory workshop that we ran on nature-based solutions in Canadian cities. And I'll get into a little bit of, you know, why we did this and why as, you know, field ecologists, we felt that this was really important. And so this is a photo of many, not all of the participants at our workshop, but I do want to give a special thank you to Dr. Barbara Fry, who was my co-lead throughout this process. Dr. Fry is an ornithologist and ecologist who works for Environment and Climate Change Canada on urban nature-based solutions and is a longtime friend and collaborator. Also, Kaylee Hutt-Taylor, who you just heard from, who was an integral part of this project back before she was snapped up by Tree Canada for her current role. And so I may call on Kaylee in some of the question periods to talk about this work, which is really, you know, hers as much as mine. And then Sarah Chamberlain Fontaine, a PhD student in my lab, and Adrina Berdekian, who you also all know from Tree Canada, who's been participating in not only the workshop, but the synthesis of this work. And so, like all science, this is work, you know, not done by me, but done by a team. And I'm fortunate to have a really excellent team for this project. Another big thank you to many, many early career, mostly student and postdoc kind of rapporteurs who helped to, you know, take notes, facilitate, translate, install equipment, do all the things associated with running a big multi-day workshop, who were really integral participants here as well. And so to set some of the context for this work, this is focused on nature-based solutions. So efforts to restore, to manage, to protect nature as a mechanism to help us deal with societal challenges. And what is really, you know, in some ways, nature-based solutions is, you know, new terminology or new packaging for things that we've been thinking about and doing for a long time. But the key to nature-based solutions is that these are ways to harness the power of nature, not only for kind of biodiversity benefits, but also for people. So we're really trying to address what we sometimes think of as the kind of triple challenge of, you know, a changing climate, biodiversity loss, human well-being. Can we do all of these through integrating more nature, in this case, particularly in our cities and urban environments? And so how can we restore, manage, protect nature in our cities to protect not only other species, but also ourselves and our communities? And I'm going to start before getting into our research and our workshop by highlighting some recent work that I was really fortunate to be part of that was led by my colleagues, Rachel Buxton and Chuck Odenigbo, among others. And what Rachel and Chuck and others did was gather a group of experts from different disciplines, organizations, lived experiences, ways of knowing, to really understand, you know, what are the knowledge gaps to guide research for more effective urban nature-based solutions in this context of creating equitable cities for healthy people and nature. And what the result of this, you know, workshop was, among many other results, there were three kind of guiding principles that came out really, really strongly from these discussions and conversations, that we need to break down power imbalances and center Indigenous knowledge, we need to learn by doing, and that we really need to co-develop research across disciplines, across perspectives, across ways of knowing nations, communities, and institutions. And so engaging effectively across sectors is really, really critical to guiding research on nature-based solutions, to creating the knowledge that we need. And this last one in particular, co-developing research, was something that we wanted to kind of pick up and continue thinking about in our research. And this really reinforced or kind of stemmed from this growing frustration that Barbara, my kind of collaborator, co-author, co-organizer for this work, had been feeling over the course of our own collaborations together, the extent to which different sectors kind of work in silos. And so for Barbara and I, you know, her coming from the federal government, me coming from a university research lab, there were all of these moments where we would be discussing something and she would say, oh, well, you know, you must know this person working on heat mitigation, because that's what your lab does. And I'd be like, no, I've never heard of that person. Or, you know, I would say, well, are you going to this meeting focused on urban forestry? And she would say, no, I didn't realize there was, you know, a meeting going on. And sometimes this disconnect was just like things happening in an academic sphere versus, you know, government employees. Sometimes it was meetings happening in French versus English. Sometimes it's that we had been approached by completely different, you know, NGOs or practitioner groups. But neither of us could really get a good handle on like who is doing this work. We're trying to work on urban nature-based solutions in Canadian cities, but there are all of these different sectors, you know, working kind of in their own silos, and it was really difficult to actually make those connections. And this is a really big problem, right? It's a problem not just because it reduces collaboration, and we know lots of good things come from collaboration, but it also leads to lots of reinventing the wheel. You know, we were seeing cases of, you know, even within government, two different federal agencies would both be working on, you know, the same problem in slightly different ways or on slightly different timelines. And we could accomplish so much more by working together. And often it's these barriers to working together that are resulting in this reinventing the wheel. And so we wanted to know, you know, how do we go from these kind of silos of research and practice to actually working together effectively across these different sectors to study and implement nature-based solutions in cities. And so if we want strong outcomes, we need strong partnerships. And what kept happening, as you know, I would discuss this with Barbara, but also with others in my own research sphere, is we would keep saying, like, if we could just get everyone in the same room, like if we could just all sit down and say, you know, what are you doing? What are you learning? What are you working towards? Why are you doing it this way? We could make, you know, so much more progress. We could accomplish so much more. And that was really the genesis of planning this workshop and how these sort of boots on the ground field ecologists decided that they wanted to do this participatory research. Now, of course, everyone in the room requires you to define everyone. In this context, who we were considering were three particular sectors. So we wanted to be able to have some discussions among academics, among government, you know, ranging from municipal to federal to indigenous governments, and NGOs as well. And we targeted kind of diversity within each of those sectors as well, thinking about different career stages, roles, positionalities, how they approach this work. Of course, this is not everyone. We could have had people from the private sector. We could have had other sectors involved as well, but we really saw this as just a starting point. Like, can we do something to get some of the right people in the room discussing, participating, and hopefully things will grow from there, and we'll learn something from this process. I also want to note here, when we talk about academics and government and NGOs, we were particularly focused on people working in the natural sciences. So working in subjects like ecology and forestry, partly we wanted to try and tackle cross-sector, but not necessarily try and look at cross-discipline and cross-sector at the same time. Again, this is a starting point, not an endpoint. We also, you know, realized through the course of our own work that natural scientists often had, you know, more challenges doing this kind of cross-sector or participatory work compared to our colleagues in the social sciences and humanities, where there were more structures kind of already built in terms of partnership research and partnering outside of the academic sector in particular. And so we got a bunch of, you know, natural science researchers, academics, university affiliated folks together with people across, you know, a range of government and NGOs. Before we did the workshop, though, to broaden our reach and to actually inform these activities, we sent out a survey. So thank you if you answered this. If this is like ringing some bells from landing in your inbox a long time ago, this was a bilingual survey distributed nationally, and it really informed the next steps of this research. So I'm going to show a few survey results, and then I'll get into the workshop and really the meat of what we've been finding and where we're going with this next. And so these results, you know, really reinforced some barriers that we expected to see. You know, people didn't have enough time or money. I don't know that any of us have enough time or money to do all the things that we would like to do within our roles. But, you know, close behind, and sorry, just to orient you, what I'm showing you here are just the responses that ranked these barriers as very important or important. And so you're just seeing the kind of strongest end of the spectrum here. And you're seeing the count, the number of people who took the survey who logged those responses. And so lack of time and resources, yep, that checks out, I think, with many of our experiences. But we also, you know, close behind that, we saw that there was a strong recognition that, you know, these things weren't necessarily in people's mandate. They weren't in their mandate in terms of like the funding that they had or the reporting that they had to do, but they also weren't necessarily recognized within their roles for working across discipline. And so for many people, you know, working across sectors, you know, an academic working with someone in government, working with someone in NGO, that wasn't within their mandate, what they were paid to do, what they were recognized to do within the context of their role. And then we get a little bit of a drop before we see some of these other barriers, things like networking, you know, actually meeting people, having the right connections to do this work, access and knowledge. And down here, you know, we don't actually see a lot of people saying that they're not interested or that they've had negative experiences. So it's not that people don't want to work across sectors or they've had bad experiences working across sectors. Is that they, you know, have either a lack of time or a lack of mandate and recognition for doing this work. We also saw a couple of interesting trends within this in terms of access and knowledge in particular. Many of those responses came from Francophone participants who saw a higher barrier in terms of access and knowledge than our Anglophone participants. And so there may be some kind of language and cultural barriers as well in terms of the siloing of different sectors. And we saw that the hardest part is getting started. So when we asked people, you know, when do these barriers occur? When does this work become hard or fall apart? It's at the beginning. It's getting these relationships off the ground, getting a project off the ground. Once something is started, people have connected, they've begun the work, there were less barriers in terms of actively working together, maintaining momentum. And the least barriers were at the end. And so it's not the finalizing your outcomes or the wrapping up that was where the challenges came in. It's really earlier in the process that we see this. And people are key. The factors that enabled collaborations to be successful were connecting with people. I at least was a little bit surprised that, you know, direct engagement was the strongest or the most important factor that allowed collaborations to be successful. This was things like, you know, cold calling someone, cold emailing someone, reaching out to someone you didn't have a connection with and saying, hey, let's work together on this, which tells me that people really are, you know, amenable and excited for these kinds of cross-sector relationships. Funding opportunities obviously can facilitate that. If you need a partner for a funding opportunity, that's going to prompt you to reach out and make and develop those connections. And close behind are existing personal connections. So people that already knew each other, maybe had worked with each other in a past role, had gone to school together, followed by, you know, place-based engagement, working around a specific, you know, saving a particular location, working on a particular, you know, urban forestry project or planting site. And so armed with all of these responses, we really wanted to dig deeper than those survey responses, you know, let us go. We also had a number of qualitative survey responses I didn't show you, people actually sharing examples of projects, success stories, failures, and those we'll pull out a little bit more later when we get into our results. But we wanted a chance to really engage with people and have people engage with each other more so than you can do, you know, just responding to a survey. And that brings us to our workshop. Also seeing that like people and connections and networking were so important and were often a barrier to engagement and getting started was the hardest part of engagement, we hoped that this workshop would help directly with some of these challenges. So not only was this, you know, a research opportunity to understand barriers and opportunities for working across sectors, this was also just very practically a way to bring people together who may then, you know, start working together, engage on projects together going forward within our region. And we did this in November, just over a year ago. And November is kind of a difficult time for many of us to, you know, take on new projects, right? And we're nearing the end of the year, we're trying to wrap things up. Academics are, you know, swamped with exams and end of semester. And so we kind of thought like, well, we'll invite some people and a lot of them will be busy and they'll politely decline and we'll have a nice small group. And instead we invited some people and the response, you know, almost universally was, great idea, I'd love to come. Can I bring a friend? And so people would respond and say, you know, this is wonderful. My colleague from another city department would also really benefit. Can I bring them with me? Or this is great, but we want our whole team of three to come. And so can you extend the invite? And so we actually ended up, you know, going back, leveraging some more funding, expanding what we were initially planning to do to bring people together for this workshop. We had, I think, about 40 people come and join us in Montreal. And these came from a number of academic institutions, University of Windsor, Laval, Carleton, UQAM, Toronto. We also had a number of kind of large umbrella NGOs that could bring that NGO perspective, also on behalf of, you know, the partners that they work for, some David Suzuki Foundation, Parks People, Tree Canada, Nature Canada, a number of federal agencies from, you know, Parks to Natural Resources to Environment Canada, Health Canada, and then a number of representatives who had worked at the municipal level for the Ville de Montréal or the City of Windsor and the Ganawage Environmental Protection Office as well. You may have noticed some missing actors. We focused on, as I mentioned earlier, government and NGO sectors rather than the private sector. We also didn't have any provincial representatives. And this is something that was reflected in our survey results as well. When we asked people, you know, what scale do you engage with policies or programs? It's happening at the local and the federal level, but very few respondents were tapping into provincial level policies and programs. And we really struggled to identify people working within provincial governments that were working on urban nature-based solutions specifically. So if you work in provincial government on urban forestry, we would love to hear from you because there really seems to be a missing sector here. Our aim for the workshop was to identify and synthesize barriers and opportunities for cross-sectoral collaboration in urban forestry to support biodiversity and people. It was really important to us not just to focus on barriers. There is, I think, a tendency, especially when you get a bunch of people together in a room who are maybe, you know, a little frustrated, a little overworked, to just kind of gripe about barriers and never quite get past that. And we really didn't want to end there. We wanted to know also, like, what are the strengths across this ecosystem of people? What are the things that are working well? Where are the, you know, leverage points that we can move past the barriers and start to make progress? And so we're going to focus both on, you know, what is not going so well, what are the barriers, but also where can we excel? Where can we move forward? We also wanted to really intentionally design this workshop to be kind of a good and collaborative experience to promote engagement, to promote outside the box thinking. I think coming out of, you know, years of COVID and mostly online workshops and workshops where you kind of go from small group to big group to small group and people get distracted and are on their laptops, we decided we did not want that experience, and we hired absolutely wonderful facilitators from Saltwater, from the community organizing space, to help us to design this in a way that would be really engaging. And that meant that we had a lot of movement, a lot of focused listening, a lot of new to me activities that worked really, really well for bringing this group of people from very different sectors together to make sure that people had a chance to discuss, to be heard. And so I'm going to share just some of the tools that we use, since I think these are really useful for leading group discussions. And so one of the activities you can see schematically on the left over here and in person on the right over here is the fishbowl, where you would have, you know, four speakers in the center of the circle. They're the only ones talking. Everyone else is observing, listening, thinking. Once one of the speakers feels like they've, you know, had a chance to be heard, they've said their piece, they can opt out into the observation circle and someone else can join. And so we're focusing on, you know, really listening and reflecting on a small group conversation rather than everyone trying to talk at once. Not everyone likes to, you know, sit in the middle of a circle and talk and speak up. And so we also did what we called a dynamic dialogue, or sometimes it's called a soft shoe shuffle, I think is another term for this. This also added a really important element of movement. So you can't be, you know, sneakily answering your emails or on your phone if you're having to pay attention and move around. And so the way this works is this is meant to elicit kind of like hot takes. And so someone would say something that they felt might be a little controversial. People who agree move towards them. People who disagree move away. And then we go to the periphery of the circle and say, okay, you disagree. What's your take on this? What's been the biggest barrier for you to collaborating across sectors? And then we continue that. So we can gauge, you know, how people feel, their strengths of opinions about different statements in that way. It also provides an opportunity for people to kind of blend in with the crowd if they want to as well and not be centered out. We also tried to deliberately create a lot of space for spontaneous connections, for, you know, chatting over a cup of coffee, sitting together over lunch, making sure we had that unstructured time, which turned out to be really important since academics, like myself in particular, really like to talk and can take up a lot of the airtime. And so providing people opportunities to meet and discuss quietly and to connect one-on-one was something that a lot of people really valued. And we interspersed our day with talks from groups who are doing this kind of cross-sectoral collaboration on the ground, and some of whom we invited via Zoom. And what we considered as success, when I say we listened to success stories, was really informed again by that survey. And so when we did our survey and asked people, what is success to you? What we found overwhelmingly was that people considered a collaboration successful when there was some kind of successful implementation. They actually implemented a project, they got trees into the ground, or when there was community engagement or recognition or network expansion. Things like publishing or funding were down at the other end of, you know, what was the most successful marker. And so we really looked for projects where we had seen successful implementation, community engagement, and we invited those folks to come and talk to us about, you know, what are you doing that we can learn from? And then we reflected on our own practices. So once we had heard from these success stories, once we had heard from a broader group, we encouraged people to, you know, sit down and reflect on what does your sector need to start and stop doing. So if you're coming from, you know, academia, like this participant here was, you know, need to start involving other sectors in the project design from the earliest stages. We need to start having networks outside of funding-based objectives. And these were really helpful pieces of feedback, pieces of data that we got through this progress project. And on our final day, we included time to actually get to work. And so we encouraged people to, you know, form groups based on mutual interests and actually spend time brainstorming, prototyping, coming up with ideas, and then coming back and presenting those to the broader group. And so we had some really interesting and exciting projects that emerged just from this, you know, one session of brainstorming throughout this workshop. Here are two colleagues, one from the Ville de Montréal, a landscape architect, and another from the Ganawaga Environmental Protection Office from the Mohawk community, outlining a way that the city and Indigenous nations could work together on, you know, plant restoration in the city of Montreal. They had like basically a full six-step process worked out by the end of this meeting. And this is a project that, you know, they're hoping to continue to work on. We had another group here that worked together to create what they envisioned as like a matching system for people who, you know, had great project ideas but needed capacity, and organizations who had capacity but wanted to connect with a project. And this is, again, these are all ideas that we're continuing to kind of talk through and discuss and push forward in various ways. Now, once we had done all this, we did this survey, we asked a bunch of people for their input, we brought people together in a room, ran these sessions, we had, you know, note takers capturing what was said in all of these sessions. At this point, we were ready to start analyzing the data. And so this was led by Kaylee and Sarah. And they have conducted an inductive thematic analysis where they basically have gone through all of that pre-workshop survey data and all of the workshop activity notes, and they've coded specific themes. So they've pulled out themes that we could then look at and analyze. And we're now in the process of kind of re-engaging workshop participants to verify these themes and writing up these results. And so I'm going to go through and I'm going to talk about leverage points. So these are kind of specific key changes within each sector that we need to address barriers to capitalize on capacities. And I'll talk about this by sector, but there are also some things that, you know, within our team we've been calling universal truths, which are these kind of documented realities that transcend sectors, that, you know, whether you're coming from an NGO or academia or government, this really resonated with everyone across the board. And what I'm going to talk about, again, are those barriers and opportunities. So you'll see these little symbols in the bottom of the slide reflecting on, are we talking about barriers? Are we talking about opportunities here? And so starting off with some of those universal truths, lack of time and resources was something that came through. We saw that in the survey results. We saw it really emphasized in the workshop. And I'm just pulling a couple of quotes here that are emphasizing some of these points. And so, you know, fear of getting involved in cross-sectoral work due to the amount of effort it takes or the potential of letting collaborators down. People are worried they don't have the capacity to do this work well, maybe because it's not supported or funded or mandated. Also, across the board, we saw a lack of appropriate support for Indigenous representation. And so here's a quote, as an Indigenous community, we want to be equal partners. I need to set a model for working with Indigenous communities. Communities should be led or be given the power to make decisions. And so this brings us to kind of capacities or opportunities along these same themes are, you know, even though these barriers were identified, there was really strong consensus that cross-sectoral collaboration improves outcomes. And there's interest and awareness for improving inclusivity. And so potential leverage points here that came from our discussion, participants really advocated for a formal database of people and projects. So some way to identify opportunities to collaborate, to avoid duplicate projects, to share resources. We really just need to know who's out there working on these things and how do we connect with them. And there was also very strong support and acknowledgement of the need to elevate Indigenous voices by supporting Indigenous-led stewardship, research, and management in urban green spaces specifically. Moving forward into government, barriers here were really the administrative and procedural barriers, so things that kind of slow down the pace. And so this idea of, you know, bureaucracy, everything is harder with forms, with processes. It takes years to get an idea through to kind of actual action. There were also some points here that led to, you know, that were a little bit controversial. And so this quote, upper managers and executives don't trust middle managers to sign off on projects or funding. We had several participants who said, well, I don't find that's true at all. I think there's a lot of trust. So all of these quotes, this is just a reminder that these are individual perspectives. They're one data point, but they can tell us something. For example, even if this lack of trust is just a perception, it still points to kind of a frustration that people are feeling that they can't effectively create change. There's something stopping them from, you know, advocating or elevating these issues. Capacities for government were that there's a lot of potential here to kind of operationalize cross-sectoral collaboration. And so if we can, you know, have measurements of project success integrated into program evaluations, into objectives, that's a way that we can kind of empower these projects, increase capacity and financing for these projects. There was a lot of recognition that government often offers a lot of financing and ways to empower other sectors to work with communities or NGOs, for example. But to do that, we have to address these management needs. So prioritizing, you know, flexibility or freedom for employees to build relationships, to do collaborative work. And in particular, we need to to hire and train people with the skills to build horizontal bridges. And so government in particular often has a very vertical structure. It can be very siloed and very hierarchical. But if we can bring in people that have, you know, really good communication skills that can act as kind of connectors or circuit breakers to clear away some of these institutional obstacles, that can be really, really powerful in terms of relationship building and working across sectors. Academia, this is actually where we saw the most barriers. So academics were much more vocal about barriers than some of our other sectors. And a lot of this came down to kind of recognition and value for this kind of work. So there is still this sort of pervasive culture in some parts of academia where people are being told, well, your research, you know, isn't going to be published in a high impact journal, or you should be spending more time on publications. Relationship building isn't really counted in the same way. And universities don't mandate cross-sectoral work. So if you're working for, you know, an NGO, for example, working across sectors might be the only way to get certain projects done and it's supported. Whereas as an academic, I could spend my entire career only working with other academics, and there would really be no push to do otherwise. At the same time, there is a lot of support for kind of knowledge dissemination, data sharing, opportunity to take risks in academia. And so a point that came out really strongly in this workshop is that, you know, as much as we're complaining about the barriers in this system, as academics, we are the system. We made it. And so we can advocate for increased funding opportunities, for better training opportunities, and we can start to adopt alternate measures of success. And so I think the good news here is that the system is changing. We're just still in the shift. And so a nice example of ways that this is shifting, for example, is this DORA assessment, which is a declaration on research assessment. And this is kind of an alternate way that we can value research rather than sort of traditionally where we think about, you know, journal articles and conference publications as measures of success. We can expand to new audiences and new scales of influence and start thinking about, you know, real world impact, team research, industry collaborations, and many universities and funding agencies are actually starting to take this on and integrate this in the way that they evaluate grants, the way that we evaluate professors. And so we're in the shift. And lastly, NGOs. A lot of the barriers here related to securing adequate resources, as well as opportunities to connect with other sectors. And so NGOs span a really large breadth, from like large, well-funded national organizations through to small community grassroots groups. Overall, NGOs were probably doing the best in terms of cross-sectoral work already. They were engaging with other sectors. They were, you know, leveraging opportunities to work across sectors. But some of those barriers around starting projects came out here, where people are saying, you know, workshops are a way of meeting people that I wouldn't otherwise meet. Like, there's a lot of limitations in actually connecting with people from academia or government. So we needed more opportunities for connection. In terms of capacity, NGOs have years of experience in relationship building and knowledge dissemination. And that means that they might play a really important role in kind of central coordination and connecting people and tracking urban NBS initiatives. Most NGOs, again, are already doing this. They're working across sectors. The rest of us should be looking to them for guidance. And so to sum some of this up, as we were, you know, analyzing these results, one of the things that we came back to is this idea of, you know, levels of collaboration in nature-based solutions. This comes from the scientific literature, where this idea that you go from, you know, level one, where individuals and organizations are kind of acting on their own, they're engaging a little bit as needed. And the higher level, where we try to get to ideally, is kind of ongoing collaborative structures. So like formal, established, embedded structures. And we're really still kind of up here. We're in this like informal collaboration between groups, but how do we get down to level five? I think the work has already started to tackle this, including work that Tree Canada is doing to build and maintain cross-sectoral networks. Just as one example, this is a recent workshop that was led by Environment and Climate Change Canada on building a national interdisciplinary urban research mobilization network. That's a mouthful, but essentially is about strengthening research capacity, bridging science and action. This was a really well-attended and rich conversation. And so I think the work is happening to bring sectors together to start this. I've seen, as I was talking, several things kind of pop up into the chat on things that you're doing, groups that you're working with. So this is certainly an ongoing process. And I'm going to wrap up here, and I would love to either take questions or comments or, you know, have a discussion around what we've been finding or the resources that you would like to see from your perspective to facilitate collaboration outside of your own sector, your own workplace. And thank you for listening and for all the great comments in the chat.
Thank you, Carly. That was a great presentation. So now we can move on to the Q&A. Before I start reading out the questions for Carly to answer them, I'm going to launch a post-webinar survey. Just a reminder that there are two questions. You may need to scroll down to see the second question.
Okay. Q&A, there we go.
I think, Carly, I think there is one question.
Okay, I see it here from Lindsay. Okay, yes. When you say you include government, which departments, how do you connect with municipal governments? Do you have insights into breaking down barriers between government departments with conflicting goals? That is a great question. So I'm gonna answer this in pieces for you, Lindsay. So when we're talking about government, we're trying to be, you know, think broadly across government departments and agencies who are working on urban nature-based solutions. And so in terms of the federal level, that meant that we engaged with Environment and Climate Change Canada, Parks Canada, Natural Resources Canada, and Health Canada. Those were the main groups. In terms of municipal governments, we had in the survey, we had a number of different municipal governments. From at the workshop itself, we had representation from the city of Windsor, as well as the city of Montreal. And from Montreal, we had multiple departments. And so there were people, for example, working with our parks department, working with our urban forestry department, working with the Office of Ecological Transition. In terms of breaking down barriers between government departments, I think that's really challenging because in our experience, and again, I don't work within the government, and so I'm happy for other people who do to also chime in. But from my experiences as someone who collaborates often with government, is that it depends a little bit on the level. Municipal governments, I find, at least my experience in Montreal, do kind of work together, work across different departments. They tend to have a pretty good handle on what's going on in different departments. At the federal level, maybe just because it's, you know, such a big machine, there's often a real disconnect between departments. So I've had conversations, you know, for example, about like carbon mapping and modeling. I'll talk to a government researcher that says, oh, my department is working on carbon maps. I will talk to a government researcher from a different agency and they'll say, oh, my department is working on urban carbon maps. I'll say, oh, great, with so-and-so. And they'll say, no. I'm like, well, but they're also working on, like, are you just independently working on this? And they're like, oh, I didn't know someone else was working on it. And it's, to me, I'm like, how can you have the exact same project happening in two different agencies and not have that communication? But of course, this happens in other sectors all the time. You know, I work on projects within my research lab that colleagues of mine are working on as well, and we just haven't connected or haven't talked. And so I think, you know, more intergovernmental, you know, I don't know if it's meetings or workshops that are needed, or if it's some other mechanism, but having more capacity for people talking across different departments is really important. In terms of conflicting goals, that's a little bit different because often what I've seen in the nature-based solution space is that people actually have relatively similar goals. They're just not necessarily connecting or talking to one another about how they're approaching them. Conflicting goals, I can imagine, for example, you know, someone is thinking about the need for increased housing and density, and someone else is thinking about the need for greening and tree planting. And there's times that those can conflict because there's limited space in cities. And again, I think it's a matter of just as much as you can, you know, have people at the same table and have people that work, you know, cross departments, that's how you make progress on those conflicting goals. But in terms of the specific mechanisms, some of the things that emerged from the people working in government within our workshop were, you know, we really need to hire people that have strong collaboration and communication skills that can kind of work as those connectors across departments. And we need to allow for that. Like, we need to make sure that our structures aren't constraining people to only talk with people or only meet with people within their own sector, which sometimes happens in kind of government or other structures where you're not encouraged to kind of go outside of your mandate. Okay, question, your last slide, collaboration moving from level 1 to 5. Is there a danger of taking individuals empowered with their own ideas of nimble, imaginative eco-action, but then moving towards level 5, it almost forces a static bureaucratic structure? Yeah, that is a great point. And so I'm gonna go back to that slide here. Okay. And so, sorry, I think this text is maybe a little bit blurry, so I apologize if it's hard to read on your end. I think ideally you don't lose the individuals and organizations acting independently. It's kind of as you move forward and you have established structures, that doesn't preclude you from also, you know, collaborating as an individual or having a new idea, or it shouldn't, in my opinion. And so I think you're right. We don't necessarily want to only be allowed to collaborate within some formal collaborative structure. We do want to keep space for people who have ideas, who are imaginative, who are doing this work. And I think we'll always have those people. Like, we all know people who are just incredibly good at kind of reaching out and coming up with creative solutions and working on these projects. But ideally then, you know, as you have these more formal structures, that also gives something for those people to tap into, right? If you have a great creative imaginative idea, is there somewhere you can go to fund that idea? Is there somewhere you can go to access resources for that idea or to publicize that idea? And so formal structures, in my mind, shouldn't, you know, preclude those sorts of imaginative actions. They should help to support them and to, you know, empower people to take those individual actions. I don't know if that helps explain, or if you want to expand on that, I'm happy to talk further.
Thank you, Carly. I think there are some comments in the chat. So the first one is from Lindsay. She's saying, in my experience, the breakdown happens with, say, the governments themselves and their departmental silos. Urban forestry departments are working with academia and NGOs, but are battling things like utilities, transportation, accessibility requirements, etc. And there is a new urban provincial parking planning for Oxbridge.
Okay, well, that's great. I hadn't heard of a new urban provincial park in Oxbridge, so I would love to hear more about that. If you have like a link you can share or any information, I'm personally really encouraged by things like the National Urban Park Program and other kind of urban parks programs that often serve as kind of catalysts for this sort of collaboration. I think you're raising a really important point in terms of things like, you know, utilities, transportation, accessibility. Those are a little outside the scope of what we did here, where we were trying to bring people who are like working actively in, you know, urban forestry and nature-based solutions to talk to each other. But then there, of course, there's a whole other step beyond that where we need to talk to the people who are not working on nature-based solutions, but are working on other aspects of our urban systems. Because you aren't going to be able to successfully implement your nature-based solution if you don't have, you know, the utilities and the transport on board, if it's not accessible. And so I think that kind of comes back to this idea of conflicting goals from the first question, where we need to bring people, you know, more than just across sectors within the urban NBS space. We also need to then bring in people from, you know, other urban sectors that may conflict, or at least on the surface may conflict, and think about, like, how do we move forward in a way that compromises among these sectors.
Thank you, Carly. And Peter Crow from Healing Forest, he shared a link and also a link of a 1 minute video if anyone wants to learn more about combined reconciliation with NBS. You can go check the link. Next comment.
Yeah, I will.
Sorry.
I will definitely check. No, just a comment there. I will definitely check that link. And this is something that in this project and in others, there are a number of really important initiatives combining reconciliation with nature-based solutions. The National Urban Parks Program, for example, one of its core goals is reconciliation and co-management with Indigenous communities. But this is also somewhere where we see some barriers as well, where often the, you know, major funding sources for Indigenous-led nature-based solutions or the major programs are really focused outside of urban areas, even though, of course, we have, you know, many Indigenous peoples and nations and communities living in urban areas as well. And so I think that there's still a little bit of a disconnect in our kind of policy and programming where we see Indigenous-led nature-based solutions as somehow separate from urban nature-based solutions in a way that is incorrect. And so I think it seems like some of these programs you're sharing are really good examples of how those two can go together.
Thank you, Carly. Next comment we have in the chat is from TJ. And he's saying, I highly recommend check out Reconciling Ways of Knowing, and he shared the link. The Reconciling Ways of Knowing Society facilitates national conversations between Indigenous knowledge holders, scientists, academics, governments, and the NGOs and private sectors in order to form the basis of mutual understanding of the benefits of incorporating both Indigenous knowledge and Western science into public and corporate decisions around land use, conservation, and sustainable economic development.
Yeah, that's great. I mean, I think the more that we have, again, kind of like structures and programs in place that help facilitate these conversations, that help facilitate bringing people together, the better. Because I think what we saw from our survey, from our workshop, is that people want to engage. People want to work across sectors. They want to collaborate. They want to incorporate Indigenous ways of knowing in their work. It's often just a challenge of, you know, who do I connect with? How do I get started? I'm overwhelmed already. How do I add this new thing to my plate? And so if there are, you know, existing societies or organizations that help support this, that's a really powerful way for people to plug into this work and to be able to make these connections. So I appreciate you sharing that.
Next comment is from German. I volunteer in my community and have noticed the impact of organizations collaborated together, but seeing your service, I understand why it can be difficult to bring certain groups together for common interests.
Yeah, I also volunteer in my community and notice these impacts as well. And I think something that can be really challenging in urban settings, so from my perspective as an academic, for example, as a professor, it's very hard to find kind of funding and capacity and resources to work with like small community groups or grassroots groups. Often the opportunities and funding that we have are really meant for like industry or like big partners that have a lot of money. And that's not the kind of groups that I, you know, want and need to work with in my research. I want to be working with the grassroots groups, the small NGOs, the local groups that, you know, they need us to bring capacity and funding. They're not offering it to the university. And that's where I think we need a little bit of a shift in the culture, and we need to acknowledge that it's really important to support these partnerships and relationships. It's not only like the big industries with funding that are beneficial to research and to the university. It's also these community organizations.
Thank you, Carly. I think German also asked a question in the Q&A pod. Are there any major case studies where nature-based solutions have become a major staple for a specific urban area? Are nature-based solutions a new concept?
Yeah, thank you for that. Is it a new concept? I would say it's a new term for an existing concept. So the idea of, you know, using nature to help solve problems, that's not a new concept, but framing it in this language of nature-based solutions is relatively new. It's emerging. It's new in terms of kind of government policy and programs. Are there case studies? Absolutely. And so there are a number of case studies. I can share a few links in the chat where you can go and look for urban case studies. They're also, one of my other projects right now, I'm working with a group called Natura to write a regional report on urban nature-based solutions for the US and Canada that includes a set of 20 developed case studies that should be out within the next year. And so there's more coming all the time. But for example, many cities are putting in place, you know, urban forests or urban climate action plans that involve, you know, tree planting and greening to help reduce flooding, to help reduce heat islands, to provide spaces for recreation for communities. You know, those are examples of nature-based solutions.
Thank you, Carly. We have a few more comments in the chat. So first one is from John. An interesting topic. I've learned a lot from provincial, regional landscape architects, engineers, ecologists, etc., and even more directly from citizens with unique skill sets. Gluing this all together is key and equally important to share stories outside of the silo. This webinar did a service to support this, and I thank you for sharing this, Carly. Most of my active MBS projects are influenced by the work of the past, thankfully often reported on for reading, review, but with current and future climate weighing in, definitely key to start documenting and knowledge sharing now, but ensuring pause to revisit the past and external groups which could share their thoughts.
Thank you for that, John. I think that comment and the one after it from Laura on volunteering, where she shares that there's often a lack of acceptance that volunteers have great knowledge and ideas. I think you're bringing up a really critical point here that, you know, citizens and volunteers have unique skill sets, have a lot of knowledge. And this is where coming back to this idea of partnering with, you know, local groups, with community groups, with NGOs is really powerful, because it's a way for, you know, us as academics or as government researchers to tap into that local knowledge and to those skill sets. But it's not always easy the structures aren't always in place for us to do that well. And so that's where some of these barriers are coming in. But I completely agree that, you know, I learn a ton every time I work with citizens or with a community group. They have, you know, specific place-based knowledge that I don't. And that's really important that we listen to people, and that, you know, this is a theme that kind of came out in the workshop as well that I didn't talk as much on, that, you know, for many academics and, you know, government scientists specifically, we're kind of used to thinking of ourselves as, sorry, my office lights turn off if I don't move enough. We're really used to thinking of ourselves as, you know, like the experts, and we need to be more comfortable with approaching this from a place of humility and knowing that, you know, in this complicated urban environment, we're not the experts on everything. You know, other people have really important skills and expertise that you need to listen to if these solutions are going to work.
Thank you, Carly. I saw you also shared the link in the chat. And we have one more comment in the chat. Laura is commenting on volunteering. In my experience, working for an NGO in a regional park managed by a regional governing body, there was lack of acceptance that volunteers have great knowledge and ideas, but the regional park managers weren't interested in listening to the ideas of the volunteers.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sorry that you had that experience. I think that sometimes that comes down to just maybe a lack of training or a lack of time and capacity to really engage with people and take on their ideas. But I think that's something that people in positions of power or expertise need to be much more conscious of, the fact that, you know, everybody has place-based knowledge that they can bring to a situation. And often it's the people who are, you know, directly on the ground, like the volunteers, that are seeing, you know, the first signs of a problem or a challenge, and can bring a very different perspective than someone who is working on this, you know, from an office or based on what they know theoretically. And so ways of bringing together that kind of practical on the ground knowledge and the theory and science is how you get to really good solutions.
Thank you, Carly. I think now we answered all the questions in the Q&A, and you've been made comments under each comments in the chat. If there are no more questions, I would like to bring this session to a close. Thank you all for participating in today's webinar session. And once again, thank you very much to Carly for the great presentation. Bye, everyone.
Thank you all very much for attending. Bye.